As an employee, you can be part of the state pension if you're a full-time employee, and you can also have your own 403B, an additional pension, but you cannot, as a full-time employee, opt out. It is not allowed. The state does not allow it. So the state mandates it for all full-time employees, and for part-time employees, if you work more than 500 hours during a school year, or if you happen to be a sub and you're a daily person, 80 days, you must be part of the system. Now, the state will allow part-time individuals to waive and opt out of the plan, but they have to provide proof that they have another legitimate retirement plan available. And then PSERS makes that exception and approves it. But full-time employees do not have an option. Whether they want in or not, it's mandated. So who's contributing? There's a local contribution, which is the school district. That figure is determined actuarially every year by the state. The state contributes. They actually contribute half of what the local is, so they reimburse us half of the local contribution. And then the employee contributes, and a lot of people don't realize that as well. Employees as a whole, 7.5% from the day they start work until the day they retire goes into that plan. There was in July 1st of 2011, the state did amend the pension plan to make for a different class of individuals. Those individuals are taking on a little bit more of the risk depending on how the plan functions and how well the investments do. So they aren't guaranteed a 7.5. They can go anywhere from 7.5 to over 12% depending on the market fluctuation. But that's only for new employees who were hired after July 1 of 2011. So all three people are contributing to this plan, and you're gonna see in 09-10 how we were at 4.7% of salaries. We now in the 17-18 budget are budgeting for 32.5%. That is gonna continue to escalate a little bit till it maxes out right now with the most recent actuarial report at 36.4% in 21-22. So you're gonna see in 17-18, we are budgeting $9.7 million for our pension contribution. Now half of that is reimbursed by the state. But if you look at that in comparison to 9-10, just a couple of years ago, you're talking about $8.5 million, half of that, again, ultimately coming out of local dollars and taxpayer dollars. So pension is one of the most difficult cost contributors to the school budget. And Steve had it on one of the first slides that two of our main drivers of costs are PSERS and healthcare. The PSERS increase for the school district from last year was $400,000. And our health care increase was $500,000. That adds up to $900,000, which is 0.6 of that 0.8 mil that we're trying to drive for. So you can see by just those two costs alone how restricted our hands are as to what we can do and how we have to find other money in other places to make it feasible for the tax increases that we do have to send to the local residents. It's a very, very difficult challenge, and PSERS is one of those costs. One of the other questions we got had to do with homeless students. What are homeless? How do you get classified as homeless? And to clarify the transportation, and a lot of people don't realize that we do have quite a few homeless students within the district and what we're required to do. So, the McKinney-Vento Act is a federal law that is there to protect students who find themselves homeless. They can find themselves homeless in a variety of ways. The family could be evicted from their home. The family could just have lost their home through a fire. Children sometimes leave their parents' home and run away, but leave their parents' homes and no longer have a home to go to. Those would all be ways that a student could become homeless. In this current school year, we are working with 9 families and 15 students. Under the McKinney-Vento Act, what is now put in place is those students are allowed, if they started school, wherever they started school, when they become homeless, No matter where they reside, they have the option of coming back to that school where they have started their education. So for currently right now, 7 of our families that started at Governor Mifflin are no longer living in Governor Mifflin and are deemed homeless. And we are now transporting to Redding, Ephrata, Wyomissing, Twin Valley, Conrad Weiser, and Pottstown. To get those students back to the district. So you can imagine on the transportation side what a struggle and a challenge that is to get those students from where they are currently living, get them back here to Governor Mifflin so that they can continue their education. Now with the law, the one nice thing is, while we have to transport, we share that transportation. So we have to do halfway and the other district has to do halfway. So that goes for our students, but it also goes for other students who aren't Governor Mifflin, but who are currently residing here but are deemed homeless. And we have 2 families right now that we're transporting to Reading and Exeter that go to those schools, and so we are doing half of the transportation for those students as well. Right now, we also have additional 19 students that are homeless, but they stayed within our district. Still a challenge as to having to get transportation for them, because that's required as part of the act, but at least they're within our school district and our school district boundaries versus having to go outside of the county and or in the further parts of the county to get those students here.
One question that we received, you heard me mention it before, is why do we have to provide money to the for-profit cyber schools across the state of Pennsylvania? Well, one, it's state law, and so we talk about mandates, it's not a choice for us in whether or not we pay for students to go to cyber schools or charter schools. If a student, a family chooses to go to a private school, whether it be parochial or prep school, that's different, that's on the family, but cyber charter and charter schools are under Pennsylvania's state law. So while we know that families and students have a choice that they can go to one of these for-profit cyber schools and have the district pay for it, what we've tried to do over the years is market our own program so that the students use our program, but again, to the mandates, we cannot force a student to use our cyber school program if they choose to go to a different for-profit cyber school. To give you a larger 30,000-foot view about cyber school, if you read the report that came out in the fall from the Auditor General, his overall summary was that Pennsylvania has the worst cyber or worst charter school law in the country. When you take a look just at cyber school enrollment, there are three, not every state has charter laws, not every state has cyber charter schools. But if you take a look at the entire nation's enrollment, there are 3 states that make up 50% of that enrollment. Pennsylvania, Ohio, and I don't want to read the slide, California. If you take a look at just 1 year experience, in 2014-15, the state of Pennsylvania sent or spent, depending on how you want to look at it, because not all the for-profit cyber schools are in the state of Pennsylvania. K-12, which is one of the larger providers, is I think it's based in Texas. The profit that went, the tuition that was paid directly from the school district, total in the state of Pennsylvania was just under $400 million in 1 year, and for Berks County schools combined, $23 million. And I also go back to that local revenue, local expenditure piece, because in most instances, the teachers or the school, well, there is no cyber school located in Berks County, so any of those dollars are going to cyber schools that might be located in other parts of the state, and possibly teachers located in other parts of the state, or even outside of the state. So specific to Governor Mifflin's experience, so since the start of Governor Mifflin paying for cyber schools, we've spent cumulatively about $4 million. There used to be a point in time where we would get quarterly bills and we would have to make the payments, but it got to the point recently now the state just withholds that subsidy amount to make that cyber school payment. So So that's how the state has now chosen to operate the funding of the cyber school. So we get the records to show the students that are enrolled, but there is no exchange of dollars from the local district anymore. It's just removed from our state subsidy. And how that amount is determined is based on, I showed you a per pupil amount earlier, but what's pulled out of there are some operational costs, things like that. So when they take a look at just instructional per pupil, that the state determines what that amount is. Our 16-17 amount is $10,400 and for a regular student, and over $20,000 for a special education student, regardless of the special education service that that student may need through the cyber school. Presently, I think as I showed earlier, we have 65 students in the for-profit cyber schools. And as we try to counter and try to provide a better option for our families, because we believe with our cyber school program, we can provide not only an online option, but an in-class option and provide a better overall program than what a student would experience in a for-profit cyber school. However, just because we have our own does not mean that we can force the hand, so to speak, of the family and student to attend on. So we have to do everything we can to market, sell, make sure we're providing strong customer service. But if you take a look at what it costs within our online program to do one student through an online option, it's $4,500 for the 38 students that we have in it versus what it costs for the for-profit side. Now, looking at that 38 number, there's still an expense on our side, but had we not had our own program, those 38 students would have been in an out-of-district cyber school program, which would have greatly increased the tuition amount that we would have paid to the for-profit cyber schools. Next question we got was taking a look at the pending legislation about the Keystone exams. We know we have grades 3 through 8. We have the Pennsylvania system of school assessments. And in the high school, we have the Keystone exams in algebra, biology, and literature. As you may or may not know, when the state first came out with the graduation exam process, it was supposed to be 10 graduation exams across 10 subject areas. What happened, the reason we only have 3 is because the state ran out of money in developing the tests because they're very expensive. And currently in the state of Pennsylvania, we just have the 3, algebra, biology, and literature. And there's conversation across the state, do those 3 tests really make up what a graduation exam should be? What about the other areas? And so as we see a strong push for vocational education, there is legislation about having vocational exams, which are, the acronym is NOCE, which is basically occupational competency exams that are given at our Berks Career Technology Center in replacement of the Keystone exams. So that's some of what this question is, and then it talks about looking at how are we making sure that we're doing some strong vocational curriculum and skill development within our students, not just in high school, but also in middle school. And I agree, and I think while it's, we talk about being college and career ready, not college or career ready, it's about being both. And we have to look at how can we be developing our skills, the skills for our students, not only if they decide to go to BCTC, but even if they don't, because we know sometimes the challenge the students have in deciding their 9th and 10th grade year, if they really want to go to a vocational school for half the day and make that commitment at that point. Yes, we have students that are ready to make that decision and they succeed, but there are some students that are not ready to make that decision. And so we do have to look back at our home school to say, how can we make sure we're providing that elective program for them to get that skill development? So should they leave high school and decide they want to go into a trade, they've got just as much skills within the high school to be prepared to enter that workforce as what they might get at BCTC. But to expand on the answer a little bit more, this is our experience. Some people may not realize that we have students that spend half the day at the Berks Career Technology Center, or they have 2 campuses, but as a district, we do pay tuition for those students to attend for half the day. So if you take a look at our enrollment, we were back in the, I think it was 2012-2013, we were at 115 students. We are now up to about 151 students that are enrolled in BCTC during this year, and I don't have the amount yet for next year. That's to be determined. And then you can see what the tuition is that we pay for a student to attend the half-day program. And then what you see in explaining all this is how BCTC does it is they determine the tuition amount based on a three-year rolling enrollment. So while you look at the numbers in the parentheses, that's the three-year rolling number that's in that enrollment. What you'll notice, that average enrollment number is a lot less than what our current enrollment is. So we do have to start planning going forward and looking at the fact that our three-year enrollment number is going to increase over the next 2 to 3 years using that tuition amount. And that's a challenge for us as a school to not only make sure we want to provide students the best education experience possible, but are there various opportunities that we might be able to find here at our high school so that maybe a student, if there's still, because we also have students that attend BCTC, they're just not sure if they want to be at BCTC. They go, they might do the three-year program, and then when they leave, they don't go into the program they just spent 3 years in. So if we can keep working with our students to better guide them through their secondary experience, there may be some students that will have, you know, skills developed through our, whether it be our technology education program, our science program, our math program, our family consumer science, and so forth. The next question, I've got a couple questions relative to special education. Some of the questions had to do, why do we spend so much on special education? Some said we should spend more, some said we should spend less. You know, again, as we said, everybody can look at that same number and we'll have differing opinions about it. But when we take a look at this idea of special education in school districts, and as, I think as Diane shared some information with you earlier, to this gentleman's question about mandates, that we have to make sure that we're following, but also making sure that our special education students get the best education they deserve too. And knowing that those students come to us with some very unique challenges, very unique needs. So about 15 years ago, I was in a school district budget meeting and a member of the community said, special education, if it's special and we're having these budget issues, get rid of it. It's special, don't do it anymore. And I understood it was good to, you know, have that conversation and to clarify where the special education come from. Well, it's really from federal legislation relative to the Individual with Disabilities Education Act. At the time that the federal legislation was passed, there was the, I don't know if you would call it a promise, but the aspect of the legislation that said that the federal government would fund special education at 40%. It's an important number to keep in mind as we go a little bit later in the slides. Each state then is given the direction, if you will, that you can exceed the expectations of IDEA, you just can't go below it. Right, so IDEA is the law of the land, and that's the minimum, but states can far exceed the expectations. And in the state of Pennsylvania, we have chosen to go above and beyond IDEA mandates that you will find in Chapter 14. But it's also important to note that we all, when we talk about this idea of compulsory education, that we have compulsory education laws that in special education, a student can be educated up until age 21. Depending on the degree of their need, depending on what their transition is, what they need to be able to enter life and post-secondary life, workforce, or living. So in some cases, we have students that are here that we're educating until age 21. The other piece to throw in there too, and this is not so much under special education, but it's worth noting, this idea of alternative education. Back when I went to school, if you were in trouble and you got expelled meant you were expelled. Yeah, that was it. You're done. Good luck. Join the army. And so, not anymore. You can no longer permanently expel a student. So if you do have a student who, whether it's behavior, in all cases, expulsion usually is through behavior reasons, violations of discipline code, while you can remove them from the regular education setting, you still need to provide them an educational program to meet their needs. And as you can imagine, if you're removing a student from this setting and moving them to an alternative education setting, which is out of district, it costs more than to educate them here. Now, do we get support for that? I'll show you that in a minute here. So, take a look at Governor Mifflin's experience with special education. This is using what's called a December 1st child count report. We have 816 students. So that makes up about a little over 20% of our overall student population. An important number when we think about the degree of needs that our students have, we do have some students, for example, in a residential setting, because the need, the 24/7 care that they need is so significant that the local school district does not have the means or the resources to provide. It might just be one student. So we do have students in various out-of-district placements. So when you take a look at those students combined, the 52, it's $1.7 million that is spent annually to provide those students the education that they need. And in most cases for out-of-district placement, those students, because of the degree of their need, could be students that go to age 21. Some conversation about how our staffing level is determined. The state provides the numbers of caseloads, the number of individual education plans, or number of students that you can have on your staffing load. And again, it's depending on the degree of need. So if you use autism as an example, if a teacher is to have an autistic student caseload, that number is 8. So they can have no more than 8 students on their caseload. So if you have 16 autistic students, you're mandated to have 2 teachers for those 2 autistic support students. And likewise, based on the different disability categories and the amount, the extent, or the intensity of their instruction determines the amount of staffing that you need to have in your school setting. That's tough to predict, right? Because the students that come to us, they can come to us as kindergartners, and we find out in February, after we've done a preliminary budget, we find out in February the students that will be enrolling with us in kindergarten and the needs that they will have. But we also have students that may enroll with us in November as a 5th grader and be in an out-of-district placement. That's not predictable. And I think off of Diane's point of where might be some uses of fund balance, there are some times that districts have to use their fund balance because that's an unexpected, unplanned cost that may hit the district budget in a year. When we look at special education, these last two bullet points are very important. The first thing that we need to do is make sure, are we providing the best education that we can for our students in what's called the least restrictive environment? So before we're looking to move the student out of the regular classroom, can we keep them in the regular classroom with various supports so that they can still make meaningful progress? If we follow last week, the Supreme Court ruling about special education came out to say the expectation is that special education students are making meaningful progress on par with their peers. And so when you have a student that already has a learning disability, think about the resourcing that you have to provide to get that student to close the gap and be as close to on par with their peers as possible. So this is a budget meeting, so let's talk numbers. In our experience, in 2008-2009, you see the top left, that was what our costs were. Again, keep in mind, large percentage of our budget towards staffing. State subsidy and IDEA, which is the federal revenue source, added up to $2.5 million in 2008-2009. Our student population and enrollment that's changing over the years. the unique challenges that some of our students are coming to us with. In 2017-2018, this current preliminary budget, we have planned for a $10.7 million expenditure, expecting to get $2.8 million from the state and federal government. If you just take a look at the far right column, we talk about mandates and we talk about following the law, but we also know we want to make sure we provide the best education possible. Look at the local experience on the left and the support from the state and federal government on the right. Over a $300,000 increase over those years versus a $4.6 million increase to the local school district budget.